The Pickwick Papers by Charles Dickens. The first ray of light which illumines the gloom and converts into a dazzling brilliancy that obscurity in which the earlier history of the public career of the immortal Pickwick would appear to be involved is derived from the perusal of the following entry in the Transactions of the Pickwick Club. May the 12th, 1827. Joseph Smiggers, Esquire, presiding. The following resolutions unanimously agreed to. That this association has heard read, with feelings of unmingled satisfaction and unqualified approval, the paper communicated by Samuel Pickwick Esquire, entitled Speculations on the Source of the Hampstead Ponds, with some observations on the theory of tittlebats, and that this association does hereby return its warmest thanks to the said Samuel Pickwick Esquire for the same. That this association has taken into its serious consideration a proposal emanating from the aforesaid Samuel Pickwick Esquire and three other Pickwickians hereinafter named for forming a new branch of United Pickwickians under the title of the Corresponding Society of the Pickwick Club. That the said proposal has received the sanction and approval of this association, that the Corresponding Society of the Pickwick Club is therefore hereby constituted, and that Samuel Pickwick Esquire, Tracy Tupman Esquire, Augustus Snodgrass Esquire, and Nathaniel Winkle Esquire are hereby nominated and appointed members of the same, and that they be requested to forward from time to time authenticated accounts of their journeys and investigations, of their observations of character and manners, and of the whole of their adventures, together with all tales and papers to which local scenery or associations may give rise, to the Pickwick Club stationed in London. Starting into full life and animation, as a simultaneous call for Pickwick burst from his followers, that illustrious man slowly mounted into the Windsor chair on which he had been previously seated, and addressed the club himself had founded. On his right sat Mr. Tracy Tupman, the too susceptible Tupman, who, to the wisdom and experience of maturer years, superadded the enthusiasm and ardour of a boy in the most interesting and pardonable of human weaknesses, love. Time and feeding had expanded that once romantic form. The black silk waistcoat had become more and more developed. Inch by inch had the gold watch chain beneath it disappeared from within the range of Tupman's vision. And gradually had the capacious chin encroached upon the borders of the white cravat. But the soul of Tupman had known no change. On the left of his great leader sat the poetic Snodgrass, and near him again the sporting Winkle. The former, poetically enveloped in a mysterious blue cloak with a canine skin collar, and the latter communicating additional lustre to a new green shooting coat, plaid neckerchief, and closely fitted drabs. Mr. Pickwick's oration upon this occasion, together with the debate thereon, is entered on the Transactions of the Club. We, however, shall not linger amongst these interesting pages, but proceed at once to the first day of the Corresponding Society's adventures. That punctual servant of all work, the sun, had just risen, and begun to strike a light on the morning of the 13th of May, 1827, when Mr. Samuel Pickwick burst like another sun from his slumbers, threw open his chamber window, and looked out upon the world beneath. In another hour, Mr. Pickwick, with his portmanteau in his hand, his telescope in his greatcoat pocket, and his notebook in his waistcoat, ready for the reception of any discoveries worthy of being noted down, had arrived at the coach stand in St. Martin's Le Grand. "Cab," said Mr. Pickwick. "Golden Cross," said Mr. Pickwick. "How old is that horse, my friend?" inquired Mr. Pickwick, rubbing his nose with the shilling he had reserved for the fare. 42, replied the driver, eyeing him askance.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.